I just got back from the Vintage Computer Festival swap meet where a ton of enthusiasts came together in New Jersey to buy and sell some incredible vintage tech. In addition to picking up one heck of a sunburn, I also had a chance to hang out with some really cool people, including Steve from Mackety 4 and Mike of Mike's Mac Shack fame. Plus, I met a number of viewers of this channel, which was incredibly cool. But most importantly, I came home with a trunk full of vintage computing. So today, let's take a quick walk around the swap meet together, look at some of the highlights, and then we'll take a look at all of this cool stuff I brought home and see what actually works. So stay tuned. The swap meet took place on April 24th, 2021, at the InfoAge Science Center in Wall, New Jersey, which is the same spot that VCF East itself will take place this October. And that's about an hour and a half drive up from Philadelphia, which isn't too bad, especially at 8 a.m. on a Saturday morning when there is hardly any traffic. And once I got there, oh man, was it a beautiful day to be outside. Although the forecast originally called for rain, it was actually sunny and 70 degrees out. And I met up with New Jersey's own Steve from Mackety 4, as well as fellow Pennsylvanian Mike from Mike's Mac Shack, who drove a whopping 4 hours to get there. And we stayed at the swap meet for the whole day, and I swear I probably combed over every table at least 3 times, and I found something new and interesting each time. And pretty much every table was staffed by fellow enthusiasts, looking to thin out their collections to people they know will appreciate them. One of the best parts of the experience was talking to people passionate about the machines they were selling off, looking to connect with fellow enthusiasts as much as they were looking to make sales. And I often left tables not just with cool computers, but with email addresses of the seller and a promise to let them know how I make out with the machine. And it seemed like everyone had good luck with finds. Steve came prepared with his minivan and left loaded with Macintosh goodies. I think he bought just about every Mac CRT there. As for me, I wound up buying surprisingly few Macintosh things. Instead, I was absolutely stunned by the Suns. I definitely have a thing for 90s Unix workstations, but up until now, I've only had my cool blue SGI Indy. But I found these two completely decked out Sun pizza box machines, as well as a bunch of super cool 80s and 90s PC laptops, and more. So let's start with my best deal of the day. This is my Zenith ZFL18193, which is an 8088 laptop from 1987 with no internal hard drive, but instead the coolest dual floppy system ever put into a laptop. I got this at the end of the day when they were blowing out remaining inventory for only $5. That's right, this incredible computer for just $5. And this machine was sold as working with some kind of a keyboard issue, but it says it boots up and has 640K of RAM, although it didn't actually come with a power supply. But I did improvise one, so we will try to boot this up. And looking this up online, people are kind of hit and miss on whether they actually like this keyboard, but I think it makes an incredibly satisfying click, and it's almost early Macintosh-like. Alright, let's plug this in, and I don't have any disks for it, so it's not going to boot, but it'll at least show us a disk error or something on the screen, so let's see. Okay, here's my power supply, and I had to reverse the polarity on it, because this is a center pin negative DC input instead of center pin positive like most machines. Make sure it's turned off. And it's alive. But let me see if I can synchronize the camera to this screen's display. Okay, so the flickering seems to have stopped at 75 Hertz, so I guess that's the refresh rate of the screen. And I think it's kind of hard to see on camera, but it's just disk error, drive not ready. But I'm a little bit concerned because this is it's a monocolor display, so it's just a white background and blue pixels, but it kind of looks like some of the lines of pixels are dead, and that's unfortunate. Maybe it's a simple recap that would bring it back to life, but yeah, at least it works, and yeah, these disk drives are super cool. Next up, we have another Zenith machine, this time a 286 laptop. And what I found so interesting about this, Master Sport 286, is the form factor. So normally a 286 laptop from this time has a huge bump on the back or a gigantic body, but this is almost a modern computer size. And it's a completely normal modern form factor, a clamshell with no weird bulging or anything. And I thought that was incredibly cool in a 286 laptop. Now, unfortunately, I don't have any power adapter that will work with this because it takes a very weird kind of mini DIN looking power supply. And yeah, none of my universal adapters have that, so I'll have to find something for this, or maybe I can fashion one. But this laptop also came directly from the VCF, and they very kindly gave this to me free if I would promise to use it in the video. And this is not the video I'm going to use it in. I'm going to use this later once I power it up, but here is your first look. Next up, we have this adorable little black and white CRT, which is not what I expected it to be. Originally, I thought it was just a tiny portable TV that had some nice inputs on the back that I could use with old microcomputers. But it turns out those aren't inputs, those are outputs. Because this is not a TV at all. In fact, this is a receiver monitor for this, a goofy little wireless camera that connects to this screen via 900 megahertz. And yeah, not what I expected, but pretty cool. So unfortunately, I wonder if I can somehow wire up the inside of the screen to actually use it as a monitor, because I originally bought it for this next thing that I'm going to show you. This is a little bit of a scruffy Radio Shack TRS-80 Color Computer 2 that I also acquired from the VCF's own collection for the incredible price of $5 at the end of the day. And I thought it would look really cool with this tiny CRT monitor here connected to it, but unfortunately that's not possible right now. But we do have one other monitor that we can test this with that's almost as cool as this tiny CRT. This you might remember from our tiny 3D printed Power Macintosh blue and white that was powered by Raspberry Pi and used this little LCD screen. And this actually is very cool because it has composite input on the bottom. So we should be able to use this with our color computer too, and this fits just perfectly on top of the unit. Now, before I hit the power switch, let's just make sure we can afford the aftermath if things go horribly wrong. So today's swap meet shenanigans are brought to you by PCB Way. Now, with more extremely useful prototyping services beyond just PCBs, including high quality 3D printing and even rapid custom CNC machining with on-demand production, it's honestly amazing that you can go from just an idea in your head to a fully realized prototype all in one place. So I hope you give PCBWay's great pricing and 24-hour turnaround a try. All right, let's hit the power switch. And apparently nothing. So unfortunately, I can hear the machine click on when I hit the power button and when I do reset, but there's nothing coming up in the display, so maybe it's the cord, or maybe it's more likely just not compatible with this LCD. This can't understand the signal coming out of the color computer too. Or maybe I have it completely wrong and I'm missing something simple that you'll tell me in the comments below and I will greatly appreciate. Okay, now let's talk about these Sun machines, which I am extremely excited about. Starting with the keyboard and mouse, which is way cooler than I expected. Now, unfortunately, the keyboard itself is kind of very spongy. In fact, it feels a lot worse than I expected it to for such a nice machine. But the way that the mouse connects to the keyboard is actually very Macintosh-like, which surprised me. And actually, it's even better than Macintosh, because look at these nice paths routed through for the keyboard and mouse wires to come out on either side. And check this out. To connect the mouse, it plugs into the keyboard just like a Mac, but these little routing paths in the plastic of the keyboard. That's quite nice. And look at how nicely organized that is. I did not expect that. So this Sun Spark Station 10 is from round about 1992, and it was a professional workstation intended to run SunOS or Solaris, which is a Unix-like operating system. And yeah, I love these pizza box form factor machines, and this is a very cool, very 90s looking machine. And it's super easy to get inside, and very heavy. You just lift up the case here, and just look at these gorgeous internals. You have a floppy drive, and you also have, well, in this machine, two hard drives. I think this could hold up to 512 megs of RAM, and I think this is like 320 installed. And you have the processor here. This machine, I think, was the first Sun that could do a multi-processor setup, although this is a single CPU. And yeah, I am not an expert at all at the internals of this machine, but I am looking forward to becoming one. But yeah, let's see if this thing boots up, and if so, what operating system is on here. Okay, so these can be a bit funky to get video out of because they need a monitor that does sync on green, and they also have the 13W3 video connector, which is this big goofy looking thing with three big circles and then a bunch of pins in it. And I have this dip switch adapter that I use for my SGI Indy, and I have different settings here for the Sun Spark Station, so I think I have it set right. Let's plug it in and see what this thing does. All right, so we have something happening. This is some sort of BIOS. We have CPU1 listed, up to four CPUs possible. We have a bunch of different memory modules, 16s and 64 meg memory modules in here. We're doing a test. Yeah, it says we have 320 megs of memory, and now, okay, so I'm not entirely sure what that is, but it says error physical address. I think this might have something to do with the fact that NVRAM needs to store the MAC address of the system, I think, and if that battery dies, then it won't boot. So if you know what this is, and especially if it's that, I'm open to suggestion on the best way to solve it. Okay, let's look at the other Sun. So this is an Ultra One, the successor to the Spark Station, and it came out around about 1995. And this guy even has a CD-ROM drive in addition to the floppy drive, so that is pretty cool, along with roughly the same ports as the Spark Station did. So let's pop this thing open, which is pretty much the same process. Just up at the back. And it opens like a car. Okay, so in this system we have half of the RAM slots populated. Here's a video card. No, here's a video card. This is also video. There's video outputs on it, so I wonder what this was used for. But yeah, a little more sparse in here. Actually, I don't know if I see a hard drive. Looks like this is the hard drive caddy, but there's no drive installed. But let's see if it powers up. All right, let's power this up and see what happens. These Suns sure like to beep. All right, Sun Ultra One, 143 megahertz and 102 megs of RAM. And it has an Ethernet address, that's a good sign, right? But it's looking for something on the network. Timeout waiting for ARP, RARP packet. Use the PROM command help Ethernet for more information. So my guess is that this machine never had a hard drive and was always going to boot off of the network. Let's see if the CD-ROM drive works. And it does, so perhaps we can get a CD-ROM to at least boot this up at some point, but yeah. All right, next up we have these two adorable, tiny, compact Contura Aero laptops, which really were kind of the first sub-notebook or ultra-portable machines. These came out, believe it or not, around 1994, originally running MS-DOS and Windows 3.1, although they can run Windows 95 officially, and I have both versions here. They came as a pair. The 425, which is, I think, a 25 megahertz 486 in grayscale passive matrix, and the 433C, which is a 33 megahertz 486 in passive matrix color. And not only did I get both machines, but I also got a docking station with the power adapter that can come out, and the very hard to find PCMCIA floppy drive. So let's give these guys a test, and then I want to show you just how cool the docking station is. Okay, let's start with the 425 passive matrix, the lower end of the two, and push the power button. There's definitely a hard drive because I hear it chirping away, and then it abruptly stopped. All right, memory test. Got some blinking lights, that's good. So we've got 4 megs of RAM. All right, and evidently it was not shut down properly last time. And what is it doing? Restarting. Non-system disk or disk error, replace and strike any key when ready. So it seems that this hard drive is dead, but probably that's to be expected from a tiny compact. All right, let's try the other one. All right, the 433C. Let's power it on. What on earth is that noise? Yeah, this one's throwing all kinds of fits. This is almost comical. It's like a car alarm. Okay, so here's the dock for the compact Contura Arrows, and I just want to take a minute to appreciate how cool of a dock this is, because if you notice, this big space here that's cut out, so the power adapter actually fits in there and then plugs in to the back here so it can be repurposed as the power supply for the dock itself. And then our compact laptop has the port on the back here to plug into the dock. But of course, I just noticed that our dock connector is a little dented. Let's see if I can fix that real quick. So there we go, plugged in. And now our compact should be powered off of our dock. So on the side of the dock here, there's a big hole, and I was wondering what that was for. And actually, Mike from Mike's Mac Shack told me, here's the battery from the other machine that plugs in right here, a little bit awkwardly, and charges. So you can actually charge 2 batteries at the same time on this docking station. One of them inside the laptop, and then a spare battery charging in the docking station itself. Okay, and the last thing we'll be looking at today is this Apple Color RGB high resolution display, which is a very nice CRT. It's actually a Trinitron, but it has a fixed resolution of 640 by 480. And this is generally the monitor that you would see sitting on top of an Apple II. And the case of this actually matches it quite nicely. When you sit this on top of that machine, it looks almost like it's part of that machine. It's a very nice design. And this being, you know, a little bit dirty, is actually in very good cosmetic condition. There's a couple scrapes and scuffs, but it's mostly just sticky stuff and dirt. And the seller said this works just fine, so let's see if that's true. I'm going to break out a machine that I love and you haven't actually been introduced to yet. This is my beautiful, new-to-me Quadra 700, a computer that I've been after for a long, long time. And these go for ridiculous amounts of money for what they are. They're really just sought after because they're the Quadra 700. It's not like they're a particularly powerful machine, although at the time they were released, they were the most powerful Macs on the market. But I bet, much like me, pretty much everyone fell in love with these machines after seeing Jurassic Park as a kid. So thanks to all of you, I now have one, and I have some huge plans for this machine, including one plan where you might actually be able to see this in person doing some incredible stuff. But today we're going to bust it out just to test out this high resolution monitor and see if it works. And really, just look at this setup. Just look at it. It's beautiful. Is there a more iconic duo than that computer with this monitor sitting next to it? And I've got this keyboard and this awesome trackball. And this is just like a early 90s dream battle station. But battle stations are only good if they work, so let's start this up. And the Quadra, actually, I haven't done any work to at all yet, so the hard drive is dead. Let me bust out a Jazz drive with a system on it so it can actually boot up. Okay, so this Jazz drive actually came with the cursed Macintosh SE30, and this Jazz disk has system 753 on it, which is just fine to boot up this Quadra. And I have booted this up from the Jazz drive before, although it has been a little finicky sometimes. But yeah, let's turn on the monitor. Oh, that is louder than I expected. And let's start up the Quadra. Wow, I can feel the static electricity coming off this thing. Jeez. Alright, so for some reason, it booted up, but it's purple. So something is wonky with the colors, but yeah, we're booted off of the Jazz drive. Oh, there we go. I think the cable's messed up. So yeah, look at that. That looks good. So yeah, the cable was pushed up against the wall. When I moved the cable, now the colors are perfect. The monitor is not as bright as I was hoping it would be, but I also see just a hint of burn-in. I see the ghost of the previous top bar from macOS, so yeah, there's a bit of burn-in, but not too bad, especially, yeah, you can barely see it when it's running unless you get real, real close to it. Yeah, this is a nice addition, especially I think I paid $50 for it. That's probably right around what it's worth in this condition, so I think that's a fair deal. And this certainly looks nice next to the Quadra 700, and especially once I clean this up and retrobrite both this and the Quadra, I think this will be a great looking set. Okay, so that'll do it for these swap meet shenanigans. I had an awesome time at the event, and the Vintage Computer Federation is such an awesome organization to support. I was so glad to be able to go to that event and meet all of those incredibly passionate people, including some of you, which was so cool. And I can't wait to go to the VCF East event this October, where I plan on getting a table, and I think you'll have some other familiar faces there as well, including one Steve from Mac84. Yes, we're talking about sharing a table and doing some awesome stuff within the theme of text adventures, which is one of the two themes for VCF East. So if you can get to the East Coast, October 8th, 9th, and 10th in Wall, New Jersey, I will see you at VCF East, and I'll have this machine there along with some other machines that you'll have seen on the channel, and there's going to be a ton of cool exhibits from all different kinds of people, and I'm really, really looking forward to it. But if you enjoyed this video, I'd appreciate a thumbs up, and if you'd like to see more Macintosh and other vintage computing shenanigans, please subscribe down below, and thank you very much for watching. And a special thanks to Dirk, Justin, Chris, Greg from RutK Mods, Sorta Eclectic, Spike, and Connor, who are my highest tiered patrons, and all of my Patreon supporters who help make these videos possible.